caterpillar.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
that's leather fezzes. Let's go. Right? Leather fezzes.
Leather fezzes.
X-Clan.
Yeah.
Right? R.I.P. Sugar Shack too.
Moorish MC, avalanche flow, watch for floaters and rhyme chunks. All I see in dress code today is bite punks. Pants off your ass, but you're wearing a belt, but don't use it. Take it off, give you welts like dad used to do it. Black with no bratopsy, no knowledge of self. Had me in stores, raiding clothes racks and store shelves. I'm from Tobago, never fell for Santa and elves. R.I.P. Gummer, and those murdered by sickle and cells. Big up the thunder, never charged me for one beat. And that's the MO of all producers that keep it unique. They know I don't keep truth discreet. Flow force abundant, lyrics won't deplete. Can't retreat now, I made it too far. While corny rappers still only write rhymes in 16 bars. I might as well too, since that's how execs brainwash subjects. Multi-dimensional MC underground like subdepths.
Now the blown up picture is Noriega putting up the 5 and the 2, just like the Moors put up the 5 and the 2. This is CNN, Noriega, gangster rappers, thug drug money rappers. Go right now, go into the tape, the little tape thing with the drawer, pull off the tape, unravel the insert, and then read the credits. This is a big CD. This is a big underground CD. CNN War Report.
Moorish MC, not a poet, not a rapper. On tracks, vocal gun, beretta, tongue clapper. Real as can be. I'm not a rapping actor like your favorite asking Ozzy Moore. Spit and drink a Sprite after. We'll teach you the law. And when he gets captured, he will get out like 3 strikes to back catchers. But you can't get out, being you're awarded a crown. Maga straight deny you due process in Moorish gown and sashes. All laws divine, he man's is average. Power of thought got gods acting like a savage. Color of law got the savage playing God's position. Then savages pray to stars so ancestors won't listen. So colonizers dissing, piss and tell you it's raining. Program your children and try to tell you they failing. Some of you need concentration camps, you don't think. Eating animal parts uncooked, it still looks pink. In order to climb charts, rappers accept exec wings. They only give you a deal cause your whack and flow stinks. Trust me, you like the exec's wings. And I think that you got a deal cause your flow stinks, nigga.
You got turban on?
Jewel master.
With the jewel? Right?
Yeah,
well, okay, so Muhammad Ali's on it. Yasin Bey's on it. Spraga Benz is on it, Buju's on it, Swiss Beats is on it, Nori's on it, Nas is on it, Flavor Flav's on it, Snoop's on it. Look at the jewel. Look at the jewel. Sisters, Real Roxanne. Right? Look at Real Roxanne with her fez with the tassel on there, right there. It's Real Roxanne. Everybody knows Real Roxanne.
Bag, and it looks like I threw everything but my Quran in my bag. I don't even know how I did that. Oh, because I didn't do that. Here it is. Great. All right. So, we're going to be having a fantastic class today, as we always do, right? But before we do our class, we always begin by reading chapter 25 out of the Holy Quran, Divinely Provide, Noble Jawali. So I'm going to read chapter 25. I don't know what page. Chapter 25, the Holy Covenant of the Asiatic Nation. If you are in agreement with it after I finish reading, affirm by saying Islam. Ye are the children of one father, provided for by his care, and the breast of one mother have given you suck. That the bonds of affection therefore unite thee with thy brothers and sisters, that peace and happiness may dwell in thy father's house. And when ye separate in the world, remember the relation that bindeth you to love and unity, and prefer not a stranger before thy own blood. If thy brother is in adversity, assist him out. If thy's in trouble, forsake her not. So shall the fortunes of thy father contribute to the support of his whole nation, and his care be continued to you all in your love to each other. Islam, Islam. All right. Well, Roz is going to be here shortly, and she has an amazing presentation for you. So, but she should be here in a minute. So we're going to chit-chat about some little minor things while we wait for her. All right? It's great to see so many sisters here. I'm loving it. Islam. Yes. Not that I don't love seeing you, son. But, you know, it's a family thing. We need more sisters, too. All righty. So, we're going to be talking about, Raz is going to be doing this amazing PowerPoint presentation entitled Who is Who and What is What. You might have heard about it from when she did the presentation down at Delaware. Well, she's going to do it here because this is Pidgin History School. All right? And so you guys need to be seeing this information, you know, as it was originally presented. And it's great to reaffirm it because people have a mental disconnect. And it's understandable when we consider that we have, in fact, been mentally conditioned. And many of us, we behave as though we haven't been mentally conditioned while at the same time saying, I know I've been mentally conditioned. So you see the disconnect? Like, I say things because I think we need to really look at ourselves. It's not that I'm trying to make people feel bad about themselves, but a lot of our people don't know how to read and write. That is a reality. They don't know how to read and write because these institutions, it's all about just getting their funding, and it's about headcount. So if they can substantiate X amount of heads, they're going to get their funding, and it's not really relevant if the people involved got to learn how to read and write. So we have to keep that in mind. So before we can even take action and doing something, we have to first correct some deficiencies within ourselves, and we have to be realistic about it, right? So if I didn't know how to read or write, first thing I'm going to do is learn how to read and write. Now, sometimes, you know, I come across information in foreign languages, and I could look at the translation, but I want to know what the actual document says. It's similar to not knowing how to read and write. So I'm going to correct that deficiency in myself. So I learned a little bit of Spanish, a little bit of French, and now I'm working on a little bit of Arabic. And it's not difficult, really. It sounds like it is, but it's not. and she's here. But I'm going to keep talking because I think she has to set up the projector and everything. I'm going to keep talking, which I can do. So we have to know about, we have to recognize the deficiencies within ourselves. And we have to first correct those things before we can step out and do anything else. Because if we don't correct them, look, we're not going to find all the answers we're looking for in a DVD if we can't read and write. That's just the reality of the situation. You're not going to, everything can't be put in a DVD. The only things that can be put into a DVD is enough to make you think and go do further research. So we have to remedy that. We have to remedy a lot of things. Like, you know, we have this misconception about government, right? What do we think government is? We hear this word government. What does it mean? Now, is that what you learned what it is? Or is that, did you check to see how I sound? Great. I'm in over the air. I don't even have my backup recording going on. Oh, my gosh. So question we have to ask ourselves is, we have to go back to before we got a little bit of information and ask ourselves, what did we think a corporation was? What did we think a city, town, township, borough, state, fed? In a nutshell, what did we think? And what did we think government meant? Huh? Did you really think that? What did you think? Did you ever think that they work for the people? No? No, I don't want to hear. I don't want to hear you because you don't even come from this landmass. People who don't come from this landmass don't count because I don't come from this landmass and I never had that thinking. See, when you come from this landmass, you have a different mental conditioning. Landmass, you come here and you're not even with this, they're the people in charge. They're the government. You have to. They tell you what you can and cannot do. Most people who don't come from this North American landmass, they do not subscribe to that thinking at all. So you don't count. You don't count. So anyway, so what did you think, government men? Authority, in a nutshell, authority, right? And when you see these employees for the municipal companies cruising by in their cruisers, did you really think that they had the authority to tell you what you can and cannot do? Or was it the fact that they had a gun and you know that hurt? Gun, right? It's the gun, all right? Because if they didn't have that gun, you would be telling them exactly where to go. You would. Look, if it wasn't for that gun and you saw that flashing light in your back window, you would have kept on going. Y'all would have been all the way to California with that flashing light behind you. You would have never stopped because no gun. So it's the perception. It's the misinformation. And where did we get that from? The school system. School system, right? The indoctrination. What can we call it? No, it's more like an indoctrination, but it's a mental conditioning. It's psychological warping. You know, it's because what it does is it takes the mind of the most vulnerable people, the children, and it warps their mind. That's what it does. Some degree, some to another degree. Like, especially like the sons, you guys are warped for many reasons, but the biggest challenge you guys have with this institution they have set up for schools is you're not born to have to sit down and be quiet energy. you guys come here with the energy to get up and go do something. Something, anywhere, something. Like, and incorporated in that energy is fight. Like, you come here fighting, your whole life here is fighting, and you leave fighting. That's the energy of the sun. That's exactly what it's supposed to be, because you're soldiers. You're born and bred, you're hardwired to be soldiers. So then the sister's been mentally conditioned to be docile, the damsel in distress. Oh, I don't know what I should do. I need someone to tell me. I don't know how to put my clothes on unless somebody tells me how to do that. You know, I can't make a move unless somebody tells me when that's so out of order. So look at this combination we got. We got the son that comes here with the get up and go, want to fight. And then we got the sisters with the damsel in distress. And then they come together. And what happens? Exactly. Chaos. He wants to get up and go. And she's like, tell me what I should do. He's gone. He's gone. He's not telling you anything because he must do things. But wow, how we used to live, how we used to perform, is mothers made sure, and to some degree she still does this today, make sure everything works beautifully. And she would give him instructions because he needs to know how to channel that energy. And who better to tell him than mother? She's not going to tell him, go out there and endanger yourself. She's going to help him to channel that energy, right? But then we go to these institutions, or you may even go to some of these institutions. Don't listen to mother. You're the head. She's the tail. So we then have another bit of confusion. And all of this, and so much more, if we can reflect on things, is mentally conditioned into our minds through this institution that we call school that really is not imparting any information except confusion into our minds. Like, there's what we learned, if we were to really look back and reflect, had nothing to do with peace. We didn't learn nothing about peace. We didn't learn nothing about the planet Earth and how to live in harmony with it. We didn't know how to determine what our life purposes are, what our strengths are, what our weaknesses are, and to work on them accordingly without any type of feelings of lack. All right? Today we have to make up for all of that. And Roz has an amazing book. She has a few books on astrology, which will tell you all about you. Now, I have delved into, I think, almost every divination there is. I've done I Ching. I've done Ruins. I've done Tarot. Did I say I Ching? And I've done astrology. But I think I've delved into every divination there is. And I can tell you, the most accurate divination you will want to investigate is astrology. It is painfully accurate. Painfully accurate. What do I mean by that? If you spin your chart, and you're going to see that your certain things you're not going to budge on. It doesn't matter if it's right or wrong. You're just going to stick with it. It's going to take a whole lot of somebody else's energy coming with that to even get you to think about changing your mind. All right? Now, in your astrology chart, it will show you that. Now, if you were like me, you're thinking, well, everybody can change. Everybody can change. Over your lifetime, what you're going to find out is most people I'm not working on changing self at all. So, some of the basic characteristics of astrology signs are absolutely, painfully correct. And you have to learn how to deal with that. Now, with tarot cards and ruins and even I Ching, that's based on my energy or the person's energy. So it's different every single time. Like if you go to a tarot reading and you're in a funky mood, that reading is going to be based on the energy of funk. If you go with this happy-go-lucky energy, the reading is going to be based on astrology chart. It doesn't matter if you're pissy mad, cheerfully happy, or down in the dumps, melancholy, it's going to be 100% accurate, painfully accurate. And when you look at your partner's energy, you're going to see, oh, my God, this is why we always clash. What was I thinking, messing around with this particular type of energy? But you don't have to let it go because there's those types of energies in there. You just have to learn how to work around it. Because, you know, sometimes they talk to you about energies and they'll get you to think, oh, my God, I can't. And then when you do their chart, you find out I'm exactly with the person I don't want to be with. And now you're thinking, how can I end this relationship? No. That's not what that means. That means that you're with exactly the person you're supposed to be with that is going to challenge you to grow within yourself and learn how to deal with that energy because you're going to encounter it again. Trust and believe. So don't run away from these things. Embrace them and know that it's the lesson. I used to work at a big insurance company, and my supervisor, I never met a sister with a mental thinking like that. It was so foreign to the female species. And I was like, what happened to this girl? And she just made my life such a living hell. I wanted to transfer, but then I was like, I'll be damned if I'm going to transfer. I made everything that I do here easy. It's flowing like clockwork. My job is piece of cake because I made it that way. I'm not going nowhere. So I started reading some astrology and some self-help book and some metaphysics, and they talked about focus on what you want, what the outcome that you want. And I kept thinking, I just want to be at peace and left alone. And I just kept focusing on that. And then all of a sudden, she was transferred to a different department. Moorish science in action. And it always happens. Always happens. I remember there was times when I was, my head little hoopsie cars, you know, and I'd be like turning up the music because I don't want to hear all those strange sounds that might mean the car's about to break down. So I'd turn up the music and I would be praying all the way home and I would be like, I don't want to focus on that. I don't want to focus on that. So I started focusing on the universe is going to provide me with a replacement car at exactly the right time, at exactly the right moment, and it's going to come effortlessly. And then out of the blue, my children's uncle called me and said, hey, you need a new car? I got one for $2,000. And I was like, so that's more science. And it's crazy because it's so obvious, but sometimes when we get stuck in a groove, like we don't want to let go of this anger, we're so angry, we want to hang on to the anger, and that is exactly what we continue to manifest. When more science says the opposite, it says don't focus on what you got, focus on what you want. It's a challenge, isn't it? That's what you want to attract. You want to attract something else. So it's a challenge overcoming those strong emotions to go that you want to go with, rather than taking control of your destiny. Because that's what this is all about. We think that we have no control over our lives, but we really do. And one of the best ways that you can control your life is with information. And that's what Ronson Riot is going to be presenting today. He's going to be presenting some wonderful information. You may have seen it, like I said, when she did this presentation somewhere else, but it is amazing to see it in the flesh. So, if you have paper and pencil, take it out. If you have questions, write them down and save your questions for afterwards so we can get through the amazing presentation of Rosmariah Bay. Oh, and look at that. She brought you guys notes. Here you go. Can you do a little bit of paperwork for notes? And where's your, oh, you're using that. Oh, hold on. Let me just, hold on. Let me unmute you. Are you near your phone? Please don't move too far away from your phone. All right, say something. It sure is, because I don't hear nothing. Did you unmute your phone? It's right where. Oh! I know how to. I know. Alrighty. How do you turn it on? Oh, all right. All right.
So say something.
I would like to say something. I am something.
And you're not Bluetooth. No, you're not.
Right.
Say something now. There you go.
It sounds wonderful.
Yes.
All right. In the middle of that bracket, wasn't there a bracket there? A bracket to hold it in, and I'm going to put it on my skirt.
What are you talking about?
There's a bracket. There wasn't on the bracket. Look at my bag. It's right there.
You know, you have to be
right there. Okay.
Got
it?
Yeah.
Now, you know I shouldn't be doing this for him right now, right?
No, you shouldn't.
No, I shouldn't. But see, he snuck it in, didn't he?
Chop your head off.
We're gonna chop your head a bit. Oh, there it is. That's the energy. It said do it. It said do it. Islam.
Islam.
Man, I really, really am so, it's still so good to be here again. You're right. Sisters, welcome sisters. Because this is the truth about your nationality and your birthright. So since sisters give birth, their absence is why the movement has not moved. And that's just the truth. Oh, man, that doesn't work too well. So it's good to see. And it's gonna really be good to see, because the presentation that I'm going to do is, here's what we want to do. Well, first, before I get started, am I all right? I am not all right?
No.
Why?
So far away.
How? I'm right here.
Oh, you're good now.
I am?
Yes.
All righty then. I got to kind of be over here because that's over there. It would be nice to turn those lights down a little, but I think we'll be all right. So before I get started, I want to make an announcement. Abdullah Al-Talib Mosey Bay did not abandon the classes. What a what's happening is we have to make this presentation that's going to take us a minute. We're doing it together. This is going to be one of those classes that, you know how you go to school and you take your history course and your English course and your this course? Well, you got this history and chronology course, and you're going to we're doing it together. So I'm going to be laying down the foundation, and then Sister E's had some other stuff. And we really will not be here after October or so, because the building won't be here. So this is our last opportunity to actually lay down a foundation of, you see, some of you may, let me say this. He did not abandon the class, and if anybody has any questions, you ask them on the floor on the record. Because sometimes when people have conversations, they have what we call conclusive questions and get conclusive answers, informal. So one go tell that, it'll be on the record. And that's what happened, and it was upsetting. All right? So we're not having that. If you have any questions, we're going to have, we don't want no one to get upset. There's enough tension going on with all that's going on today anyway, and the redirecting to the Moors into processes that it's going to absolutely injure them. So you got a question, you ask it here, it goes on the record. Nobody has to remember or say, I said, you said. Don't ask us no questions informally now because of that last time we were here. The misunderstanding, or the construct, like I said, we do what I call conclusive conversations, conclusive answers, and it wasn't personal. Well, conversation was personal. But anyway, so let's move on. This class, I want you to think about the reason you know what you know today in reference to history and what you think is government and what you think is the truth of history that you never question is because someone taught it to you in school, correct? You went to the history class, you went to the English class, you went to whatever class, correct? And so you walk around today because that's what was taught to you. So now, we know instructions from elders says to teach your children and to get it into your children at all costs. So the presentation of history, what was given to you is a chronology that really is basically the syllabus for the most part. Now, some people say, why is that important to me? Now, it's as important to you as the stuff that you already walk around with that you were already taught. Right? So why not get the truth about the history and the chronology? Why is it important? Because you need to know, shall we say it together? Who is who and what is what? Because failure of knowing that leads you to live in someone else's created reality. Because we can say to you, these people are not government. They are corporations. We can prove it to you. And then some people will say, well, they do this and they do this, and they said they were, and they, and all that. So you are living in the reality that they created for you to live in, for you to breathe and walk in, right? And it influences what you think and do and everything. And just like that, it can change. Because the only true answer is truth. The light is truth. Truth is light. But the fear is what keeps us from getting there. So what is the fear? The false, and it's not a joke, it's the false evidence that appears to be real. So every piece of paper they give you about whatever is the evidence that it's false, but it appears to be real. So even though we may not be able to change the adults, like we have instructions to get it into our children at all costs. That's the other reason why women have to be involved. This is no joke. Because she's the first teacher. And that's never, ever, 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 ever going to change. Because the first school womb is right here. So that's why if she knows, it's automatically pumping through the blood and the spirit of the body that you're building. You know, we talk about, you know, we're spiritually connected and the crystals and stuff are going to help. What makes you think that you can't, that you're building Solomon's symbol up in here and it doesn't affect?
You're the master builder.
Exactly. So when they say the grand architect built soul of man's temple, which is the body, where did he build it, they say? In the darkness, in the silence, with no hands and no tools. They're talking about women who's pregnant with the baby. That's soothing, isn't it, mother? Five times you did it? All right. She did a six. Yeah, I know. So, well, me, one. But it's okay. It's all right. I mean, whatever. Divine law governs all of that. So, but I came from a large family. Six girls, two boys. So I came from a large family, yeah. So with that being said, that's the other reason why. No, let no one mislead you from that fact. Because why? Because that can not change. Ever. So, same goes with teaching this chronology of the truth, of the history that you didn't get because someone else created the reality and they didn't want you to get it. So you live that reality. Now, by saying that, we can also say how easy it would be to change it. Because it's the suffering is from what? Lack of knowledge. So now that we know, it changes. One thing we get to know, who is who and what is what. And let's start with who and who is who. You think this over here is something that it absolutely is not. And then because it's been impressed upon you and they play the position of it, why not? The only reason why it stays that way is because you and I believe that it is and we thereby treat it as if it is.
The Wizard of Oz.
The Wizard of Oz. That's right. Great movie. So we can change that. Matter of fact, you can't help but change it. Now, what happens when you change that based on your knowledge? Because you can only be what you know, you suddenly are starting to be who you are. Yes. You, because even Prophet Noble Drew Ali said, I have come to teach you to be yourself. So being yourself doesn't mean it has to be difficult. Being yourself doesn't mean you have to prove anything to anybody. You just have to be yourself. And it just comes naturally, doesn't it? Right now you're being yourself in a fiend reality that you had no control over whatsoever, and you keep buying into it and living it out. Simplistic. You know, you buy into someone says, well, we are, you know, we're the government, and you don't know what government is, so you think that means that entity or group has an authority over you. So you just gave your baby to them in mind. So free your mind and your behind will follow. So this is why you and I have kept following and believing the same thing because our parents said it and did it and said it and did it, and that's why. So and when you start to unfold to be yourself, that means you know who you are, so thereby you shall be who you are, and then suddenly you realize who someone else is not. And then you begin treating that way, not in anger, not in emotion, not in any of that, because the real reason that this can be needs to be done is for the children. So let's say that you say, well, I'm going to, because you know, you might be all tangled up, as we all have been, and you say, well, I'm going to teach it to my children. Great. It's got to start somewhere, right? But then you're going to teach it to your children, but you're not going to do it yourself. Well, eventually, that's not going to work.
Yeah.
it's a exactly because children are innocent souls, and they're more logical than at 7 years old they begin to reason. At seven, which is in conjunction with Uranus, the changing of the body, the bone structures, the teeth, you know, the development. So at seven, they have reasoning factors, and they're very logical. And then we teach them not to be logical. And that's a problem. Straight to belief. And belief means you really believe something. Let's get real. It means, I don't know. I believe it. And that's how and why we don't manifest our own reality. It's not a spooky thing. It's not a kumbaya thing. It's real talk. It's ABCs, for real. It's just logic. Because first you think it, then you speak it, which gives it fertilizer, right? To speak it into existence. Well, first is the thought, which is the seed. And so let me put it a different way. So you've got to graduate from believing something because your mommy said this is what this is. And that's why it's a shame when we trick our children, you know, because they believe what you said until they realize how to know it. Because it's only in knowing can they use that and move to faith in what they what? Know in order to manifest what they want. That works for all of us. It works for all of you. You have to have, in order to get fruition, it's not out of what you believe. So I've been learning this lesson. Oh, yeah, you thought that you were thinking positive, but you didn't really believe it. It's true, because when you do, it just comes as natural as the holy breath. There's no restrictions. I really get it. There's no restrictions. There's no, oh, this may go, this it might not. That means that you don't know, and so you're admitting that there's something else that could override you, right? So you have to, as children and as yourself, you believe it. ABCs, I believe it because my teacher said they're ABCs. Then you start writing words with ABCs. Do you believe it anymore? No, you know that they're ABCs. So then you begin to manifest the sentences and the paragraphs. That's just an example. So whatever it is that you have believed, once you graduate to knowing and stop being a believer, I'm giving this up. You graduate to you know now because we suffer from lack of knowledge. Now with what you know, you have faith in what you know, and surely it shall become the reality and manifest. So these people have created a false, I don't want to use these terms, people go paradigm and this. No, this is just, let's just get, huh? False appearance, right, fear, false evidence of being real. That's their reality that they plan to put on you. And we keep saying, yeah, that's what it is, yeah, that's what it is, there, this. You know, the policeman who's a policy enforcer is really a law enforcer, and he comes to the school as in another very serious, shame on us, serious family, serious problem. And they'll come in to the schools where your babies are and tell them, you know, we're the law enforcement. If you have a problem, call us. That ain't supposed to go down like that. That's not how you build trust in a child builds trust in his community or his family. But that's a lie. Because, first of all, they're not law enforcement. We're not trying to get, you know, what's the word they say, semantic. No, it's real talk. Because the law really is you manifested in the flesh. That's first and foremost. And if you don't see that as you being the law, lent that angle in with, and you're going to give that to someone else, and you're going to teach your children to give it to someone else, and then you wonder what's wrong. You know? You need to put that in order. You need to have the 7-year-old that knows that because he has a reasoning mind and can figure it out. the one I'm going to present tonight, he or she can figure it out. It's not complicated. It's just not that it has not been before us. Because the reality that they wanted to create was the reality they wanted to create by suppressing your thoughts. So here's what you have to do. Don't get angry. Don't get none of that. Think of yourself, your brain. Can you just hold this for me until I'm done? Yeah. Think of this as, here's your brain. You went to school. And look at it as compartments for a second. And over here is the compartment that deals with history. And right here is, I'm not saying this is true, but I'm just saying. But still, over here is the history, and over here is math, and back here is English or spelling, not English, spelling, because you cast spell. By writing is casting a spell. So and then math and then whatever. They get different compartments. Well, the problem is someone comes up to you and says, this is the truth about the history, and you don't know where to put it because something else is already there. So to get, you got me? So to get the something else out, you got to have the exorcism and then get rid of it. That's it. Not going to the church with Reverend so-and-so and, you know, being dipped in the water, but it is the original baptism. I'm sorry, I said exorcism first, then the baptism. The original baptism of all beings is the mother's womb. Those are the true baptismal water. So that child is being baptized in your womb. That's why we need to act right and understand the importance of what's happening. So we've got this stuff, and we've got to get rid of it because over here in this part of the brain, wherever that may be, where it's history, you got some other stuff. And so this is what the prophet meant. We talked about this on the air the other day when he said, I could tell you everything, but you would go back to sleep because you're trying to compute. You've got to get and your eyes are open, but they're shut because you can't compute all that stuff out fast enough. So therefore, you learn by degrees, right? So they set up a system where you you graduate here, then you graduate, and, you know, so on like that. Mm-hmm. So the basis of the learning by degrees would be the foundation of information, right? It'd be the principles, right? And that's why the principles, lost your free freedom and justice, for instance. Great principles. They're never going to change. I don't care what anybody do. I don't care what anybody does, what anybody says. Principles never change. So if you keep the principles, you're good. That's why they were called principles. Remember these five is how many? Principles. So similarly, we're talking about foundational base, correct? So let's look at this as the foundational base of the chronology of history, because it is. And once you know who is doing what is what, you're good. Automatically, we'll stop doing half the things and thinking half the things that we're thinking. So now, presentation? No, that's not it. That's presentation JPEG. Oh, PowerPoint. Sorry. All righty then. Can you just hit it for me? This thing working right here. Yeah. Who is he? Part two. That I don't want that. Who is who? You're only getting part one. That's the one right here, right, Jay? Yeah. Okay. I'm working on the part two. Or shall I say on the degree, the next degree. Because degree literally means day. And day by day, you learn. And day by day, you take your daily bread. And man does not live by bread alone, but by all that comes from his mouth. Because that's the casting of the spell. And since we haven't been knowing anything, the things that come out of our mouth, is what we have, which is gets our behinds in trouble. And not to mention what it does to our psychology, our psychological state. Where's the button that makes this the whole size? Is that the whole size, Dave? I can't see it. Is it over here?
Are you talking about the size, the one that makes it go down?
No, I want it to wide the whole screen.
Oh, it's on top. It's on top. It's actually that setting right there.
I can't see it. Can you just make it big for me? Unless it's big enough.
It'll be right there, view. Right to the file, edit view. Right up here.
I can't.
I can do it.
You can't.
I can do it.
No, I want the wide screen, not the percentage, but it's okay. It's usually in the corner, but it's okay. It's all right. It's usually right here, right down here. But it's, huh? I'll let go of the mouse. Let go of my ego. Let go of my ego. There you go. Is that better? I just kind of thought it might be. All right, so this is No, Who is Who, and What is What. That's our series now. And Take Your Place. All right? Now, one last thing, because I just can't see. Can you tell me where I click at? Cause, yeah, I can't see. Can you move that chair?
Yeah.
I'll click the picture, it'll do it. All right, never mind. Got it. No, it's okay, brother. You can still use that for your little side table over there. No, it's all right. I got it. All right, important definition, premise. Premise means the foundation, you know, important. Colonist, dependent, political, community, consisting of a number of citizens of the same country who are emigrated therefrom to people another country, right? Then they're not from it. And remain subject to their mother country, which is why they had to have the capital put up. It's their connection to their mother company. Now, settlement in a foreign country possessed and cultivated either wholly or partially by immigrants and their descendants, who have political connection with and subordination to the mother country whence they emigrated. Now notice it's immigrate and emigrate.
Yeah.
Do you want to know, you know the difference between the two?
No.
All right. Now I'll tell you. It's going to really help to get to know who it is. I'll tell you. Emigrate means that they have left land.
Yeah.
They're not on no land yet.
Okay.
Wherever they end up, they will enter as immigrants.
Okay.
So they emigrate. They left.
Yeah.
They're in the process. As soon as they hit land, wherever it is, you look at them and say, look at them immigrants. That's the difference. Okay? That's a fact. We went to Ellis Island and, you know, got information there. But you can look it up. That's the difference. That's the only difference. So with that being said, do they admit that they're the colonists? You know that, right? Everybody said they told that. We know that. Oh, my goodness. Oh, yes, they, well, in their history they do. In their history they do.
We came on slave ship.
No, the truth is they came on the slave ship. Yeah, but the truth is they came on the ancestors, I mean on boats by the drove. Isn't that funny? Because it's a 180, ain't it? Flip script. Mm-hmm. Instead of heritage, meaning her age. See, heritage is her age. So we need to know our heritage and the history. And they leave out the heritage because their foot is on her neck because you're the one who brings the beings that will have this knowledge or not. so where we can have it so that you're suppressed. Even if we can get your own son to suppress you, we've done well. And that's where we're at right now. Not his fault, though. It's your fault. This is your fault. See, they have it really switched right now to the point where this has to stop. They actually have him, you know, giving him your baby as if it's his. But they started that by him putting his name on you when you got married. That never happens. We don't do that. How are you going to take your son's name? He's your son. But what happens is, because that's all it is Mason, mother and son. What happens is that's the plan for their reality. So that's why it's yours. But it's not. It's against nature. The marriage license came with the modern Europeans and their Magna Carta society. You know that. And it came to keep him from marrying their women. How do you get to get into that? You see what I'm saying? So if you get you with, we're into it. It's not going against that. We got to see what things really are and why. So then what happens is you can't do your true heritage. You can't know who your mom really was because they wiped her name out because they gave you his name and he came out of you. That's crazy. But that kills your name. And Annie has explained that many times. She says, and we see it all the time. I'll say, well, what's your nationality? They start talking about what their daddy is. Because mother is not in it. But she gives, you know what I mean? There's no blood. When the sperm hits the egg, there ain't no blood exchange. This is about bloodline.
It's just water to the sea.
Nothing, you know what I mean? They have a duty. They're the warriors. They take care of family. You haven't given them the order to do so. We, because we're living in another reality, and it doesn't belong to us. It belongs to someone else who put it on us to keep you from ever being able to get to other degrees. Just stay down. Many of you don't wake her up. That's all. I don't care, because that's the wrap. So I said all that to say, so now we know who they are, right? Emigrant without the I means they're in process. They have left some land. You know, somebody booted them out. They out. They're floating on land. They're in between locations. You know, it's what's the word I'm looking for?
Went to some place that they want to call not Israel.
It doesn't matter. Here's the point. Yeah. It doesn't matter if they leave that piece of land right there, and they leave there now when you see them. Traveling, they're emigrants. When they land, well, in the water, right? From one land. When they get to the other land, as soon as you see them coming, look at them. Immigrants. They, no matter where they land, they will be immigrants when they get there. Emigrants mean migrating. Just think of migrating. Migrating. E with an E. They're in the process of migrating. The process of moving. You know, but when they get to wherever it is, I don't care where it is, they are technically, lawfully, actually, and truthfully an immigrant.
Yeah.
You get it?
Got it.
All right. So that's the difference. So what's the definition of American?
Want me to read it?
Yeah.
An aboriginal or one of the various copper-colored natives found on the American continent by the Europeans, the original application of the name.
Everybody's seen this definition, right?
Yeah.
Good, because, you know, we put all that information out there. We hope that it got reached out. So this is telling you that when they got here, they saw people that look like me and you. We got different colors, tones and stuff, right? It's affirming it, right? How do you forget that? I mean, we shall not forget that from this point forward. So this is just the premise. Here's more of the premise, I apologize. True, modern Europeans, Slavic. They are the slaves. The shortened version of Slavic is slave, not you. Modern European Slavic / British subjects, because that's what they were. That's why they had to be free from the British, correct? But do you know that the British are the brutish Moors, your cousins?
The ones that wear the wig are in general war.
Hmm?
The ones that act like the wig ones, the wig of war coming out, the wig of war.
No. No. The British Empire, why do you think they say the sun never set on the Moorish Empire? Because the sun never sets on the Moorish Empire. Because it's up over here or it's up over there on the other side. The British Empire, or the brutish Moors, what came from them, like slaves, you know, the whole amalgamation thing, they're called Englishmen. So when you hear English attached to British, but British is superior, English is inferior.
Okay.
All right? If you look up the word Englishman in an Oxford dictionary, it'll tell you that we are but a hybrid. All right? Now, let's just get this out of the way. The brutish Moors, which is our cousins, treated these Slavics very, very, very badly. I don't blame them. They have trauma shock when they see a brown-skinned person. And they want you to have the same thing, but it has to had to stop. So that's why we did what we did, and we had the treaty, and we bought, I mean, well, they came over for commerce, but they didn't want them to do commerce. They were kicking them, and pirating them, and beating them up, and all that kind of stuff, and really horrible things. So they wanted to be free from that, but mainly the Declaration of Independence had nothing to do with freeing them as slaves. They were just being free to be independent, just like people now. Oh, I get my own business and I don't have to. Yeah, that, you know, they wanted to be free to do trade. So, the modern European Slavics, the / British subjects, because they're still British subjects. And guess what? They're trying to make you British subjects. And no, they're not trying to make you. Forget that. Nobody's trying to make you Jack. You think you're a British subject because somebody told you that. And so you got people talking about English law and imposing it on you when this is America. English law has nothing to do with you. It has to do with the British subjects, which they are. They want to be free from that. That's them. You ain't never had to deal with that, but you receive it as if it applies to you when it does not and never did. You get it? So, treaties between, okay, where am I at now? All right, so my European Slavics, British subjects, were brought to where? North America, to work in British companies and plantations known as English colonies under the British rule. So the original plantations on this land, that they were in it. They were for them. They were working them, not you. Treaties between Great Britain, your cousin, Moors, and Morocco, us, allowed them, they said, okay, we'll let you bring your companies over, not your slaves. That wasn't what it was. It was that the British Moors wanted to come here and set up companies to do business and trade. It just so happens their workers were the Slavics. So they brought them over to work in it. So they're the first ones that's working in plantations and farms, not you. Some of them, as a matter of fact, we went down to North Carolina, and Berkshire, who's one of Berkeley, who's one of the ones who signed the Declaration of Independence, is right there on the plaque. He was born in that plantation. So he was born as a slave. This is what study does. Like, oh, shoot. It's on the plaque that he was born there, and that he ended up, it was a plantation. And the year in which he was in the plantation was before the Declaration of Independence. So you got to start doing the math. Like, oh, Berkeley was born a slave. Or they all were born slaves. But he was born in this plantation and ended up growing up to be one of the young Slavics who ended up signing his John Hancock on the Declaration. See what I mean? So they were fighting for their independence. Why not you? It's easier for you. It's so much easier for us. The only reason why you're so, I mean, we do have it. It's just a perceived.
We're here.
We have no, right. So, So the treaty between Great Britain and Morocco, allowing Great Britain, that's the British Moors, to set up these companies, colonies, go back as far as 1100s with King John and 1500s with Queen Elizabeth via Sir Walter Raleigh and 1600s King Henry IV, that's the French. There was French colonies too. Companies, excuse me, because when you say colony, it's a company. And today it's the state that you think has rulership over you. You see it? All right. Once Great Britain saw the companies were profitable, they would take the companies away and put them under the royal crown. They would tax the imports and exports and do hostile takeovers, inclusive of making false charges and having trials without jury against them and other unjust treatment and brutal acts. Sound familiar? Yeah. Okay. It's called, karma. Karmic debt. Consequently, they desperately and fearlessly desired freedom from the mistreatment and to become independent companies with a vengeance. China died. They'll die for their freedom. And that's how it is. Note, king is not a noble title. I have this down here for reason because of the next slide, I say, of a or for a Moor. It is a title of one who is ruling over Slavics. It is not matriarchal. But that's why, you know, Roger Burns said, well, I'm king so-and-so. Now, you're not English. It doesn't mean that you didn't have the title to rule over Slavics. But you're not going to tell me that you were king over your family and me because we're not Slavics. So it doesn't belong to your family. It's not a matriarchal title. You understand? All right. Now, the chronology is in your hand, in the little booklet there. And to sum it up here, modern European Slavics band together, right? We set the premise, right? So they was getting beat up and all that and mistreated and all that, right? It's still not, they're not free, independent here, but what they did is they, announced 1643, this is the Articles of Confederation of 1643. This is something they did. So modern European sovereigns band together and formed a union amongst themselves called the what? United Colonies of New England. If you do the history, United Colonies of England is the Union USA today. I'm going to show you where it's on the record, for the record, let the record reflect, and you're going to read it, where they changed their name from the United Colonies of New England to the United States of America. I know you didn't know that. Neither did I. When I, sister, it kind of led me towards all of this. I was like, oh, my goodness. Let me put this all in the thing here. It's amazing. So now keep your mind thinking, 1643, they did that. Right? What's the next thing? Read it out loud. Okay. Stop. Who told you to go and look at what they call the Constitution of 1774? Who led you there? Prophet Noble Joe Allen. What did he say? RVBey publication. It is on there though, and you're gonna have an assignment. For the next time we come, I don't know whether I'm going to give it or you're going to give it. They should do it for next week, right? Yeah, because it's already on the site. It's like only like 7, 8, 9 questions. It's called Comprehensive Reading. If you really want to know how to understand things, you read it, and then you have the quiz. Oh, the answers are right in what you just read. That's a powerful comprehension builder exercise. Right, but anyway. So, that's the test that the question test that Anna Ed created for both this article 1643 and 1777. We haven't got that yet, but I'm trying to do a chronology. So, on September 5th, they asked for help from the what? The existing Continental Congress at Philadelphia, Articles of Association of 1774. So, there was already a Continental Congress existing before they even became independent. The article says, they say, we're the United Colonies, come to you, and, you know, basically we're going to abide by what you say, help us get free and gain our independence. At an existing Continental Congress at Philadelphia, September the 5th, 1774. All right? You got your mic on?
No. If you have read and studied Nobujrali's writings, he led you to the Articles of Association. He said, go and check out the Constitution of 1774. How many people read that? So we went back looking for this Constitution of 1774 and came to...
We couldn't find it at first.
Articles of Association.
You know what? We couldn't find it.
He left keys.
It was a key.
Research.
But we wasn't going to stop until we did, because we knew that if he left it, it was real.
At this time in 1774, the existing continental problem, is that Morocco?
Yes, all of this is Morocco.
No, what are they under? Like, what name are they under? If this is... We got the British colony coming here.
It's still Great Britain.
Okay, so this is still Great Britain?
That's still Great Britain.
Okay. That's what I'm trying to understand.
No, they're coming.
Yeah.
They're coming to, you'll see it unfold. They're coming to ask to help to get freedom from the brutish Moors who have them, you know, in captured.
Oh,
no, they don't have freedom with their independence. They want to be independent with their business, okay?
Yeah.
So they had to come to the existing Continental Congress on this land.
Yeah.
They're not free yet. How do you allow someone to wipe out this history? It's recorded. It's what they talk about. But they don't teach you?
It's so crazy.
All right, hold on. Let me get through this. So this is what's happening. I'm just giving you a chronology, and then we'll tie it all together. I'm going to give you the opening of each one of these things. So it says that, so... When they did this, on September the 5th, 1774, I wanted to say something. I want to throw something in here so we can understand. All right, why did they do that in 1774? Let me show you this. The Boston Tea Party, you all heard about that, right?
Yeah.
All right, they were being taxed, right?
Yeah.
They were being taxed out of the Gazoo or whatever.
Yeah.
Well, that was in 1773.
Okay.
They just did the Popeye of... taking all that I can stand until I can stand no more. So they went to the governing authority at Philadelphia, the Continental Congress, and said, help us to figure out how we can become independent. We promise we will do and follow whatever we have to do. We just need to be independent from these maniacs. That's how they were saying it. But it really wasn't a maniac. Well, they were, but they wanted to be independent and not have a foot on their neck. Problem is, you can't go to nobody. You are the it. Because everything that we think, like if we're thinking along this line, is not the same for you. They came to you. You didn't come to them. You understand? And everything that you think you need to do what it is you need to do is already in place. You're just not walking into it. You know what I'm saying? Like, how many times have people... we're going to go to the United Nations in, you know, March. What are you watching for? These rights to do help. It's already done. It's in the rights of indigenous people. Enforce it. See, because of where we are, because we're not taught to, you know, think out of the box or be out of the box. Oh, no, we're not taught to be who we are. That's what it is. So when they did that in 1774, it was because they had just had enough about the Boston Tea Party, and there was one more. In 1643, the reason they really band together is because the French was fighting somebody. The French wasn't fighting them, but they was like, oh my gosh, here's what it was, 1765. I knew it was one I wanted to go in between before I got to 1776. 1765, I just didn't add it because it's not a part of, you know, this, but it happened. The Stamp Act, you've heard of the Stamp Act? Yes. That was another one of really we've had enough until we can't we can't stand it no more. Because the Stamp Act is when they were actually going to, they were overtaxing them. That was 1765. So now, in 1774, after the Boston Tea Party and everything, they clinched together and they band together and they became the United Colonies of New England because they was really basically left here to die, right? So they band together and they went to the Congress on September the 5th. And then that was after they, you know, seen the Tea Party and the Stamp Act and they're being taxed up this kazoo. Okay, so I wanted to throw that in there so that you wouldn't wonder where that is. They told you that. They always threw that down your throat, but they didn't throw this. So before they get to drafting this independent document, because they were told when they went to the Continental Congress that that's what you have to do. Got to put something in writing, don't you? Just like, okay, I'm going to slip it in, Annie. We keep telling people, write your cause of action. What happened to you? Law is writing. It's the written document. It's the writ. So before they went to, I mean, after they went, they did a couple of things. You see what they did here? They was piecing mad, right? They wrote a dissatisfaction letter to the people of Great Britain. That means to the Moors. I'm going to show you. It's in here. Then they wrote a similar letter to the British colonies at Quebec. That's why you hear always hearing about Quebec and the plantations there. But you thought it was you. It's not. So they asked, so then, because the Continental Congress said, look, this draft, you gotta write this. They declared, they drafted and submitted their declaration of independence of their company. If you read it, it's clear. They're not talking about freeing their behind or chains coming off of them. It's really about the company. Because British was saying, you're going to work for me all day, every day, and I'm coming and I'm taking everything you make. And if you don't like it, I'm going to, what I said earlier, you know, make up a fake trial and send you back to England. I mean, Britain, and put you in the brig. Yeah, that was what was happening. Sound familiar? So they also, yeah, okay, so that's what they did. They just like, you know, all right, I've had enough, and I'm writing all my love letters right now. I'm done. I'm going to war now or whatever. I'm done. So that's what they did because Quebec was a British plantation, and some of their family was there too. So what happened when they wrote that letter? See, now, 1776, they wrote it. You see how I have requests was not received yet? They didn't get free until 1783, 7 year war later. There was a couple of 7 year wars. They really didn't get their independence until 1783, 7 years later. But they're still going to stand prideful in the 1776, and really they established in 1774. Why? Now, let me go back. Why is that called the Articles of Association and not Confederation? Because at the point, no, okay. Yeah, because the point that they walked into the Continental Congress, where your people were, our family was, they became what? Associated. So the prophet took you to Articles of Association, or he called it the Constitution of Association, to show you something. They came to you. In your existing state of mind, when I say state, and being. You see, that's why he sent you there. He said, go back to the mindsets of your foremothers and forefathers. He said, you have a what? Illustrious history. So he started pointing you in a direction so that you could say, oh, wow. They're not free yet. That's not them. They weren't the Continental Congress. So now, when they drafted the Declaration of Independence, what did it do? The British Moors was pissed, kicked off the war. 7 years. They didn't want to free them. I mean, They didn't want to give their company the independent freedom company. So I kicked off the seven-year war at 1776 to 1783. And 1783 is when they technically got their independence through the Treaty of Paris. Why Paris? Because it just happens to be where the Moors met. That's why. Because, see, when you say Paris, you think of modern Europeans, those quote-unquote white people. You do not think of yourself in any way, shape, form, or fashion. But that's where the British Moors met. That was their conference room. Ours was the Continental Congress on this end. Maybe it was another post somewhere else or somewhere else. That's all. It's not complicated. So let's move on. Now, while in 1776, even though the war kicked off, they're standing behind the enemy lines like, oh, man, I can't wait to get that independence out. I guess we'll get it, right? But they decided to do something in 1777 while waiting, right? What does it say they did? They decided to style their union to be called the United States of America. And you think you're a citizen of that. So when the Constitution comes and it says Article 12, you as descendants of Africans, you can't be citizens. Let me show you how screwed up we are. We want to complain. Why can't we be citizens? They trying to exclude us. Do you see how the mind works? You see? I'm going to show you the proof. This is still the syllabus. I'm going to just only show you the beginning paragraphs of each one of these to substantiate them. I'm not reading them all. You read them. I'm not reading them, but they're all on the site, every last one of them. Or you can, get them because they're documents of history that they just put over here on the side. They just said, because if you knew that, you've got the thing. If the seven-year-old child, would they be able to figure this out? And you are that seven-year-old child all grown up who never figured it out because it was never put on your plate. Simple, right? So this one, 1777, is the Articles of Confederation. And at that point, there was only 13 colonies. And after that, they said they went around, join or die. We're going to join a union. And then it went on. I'm sorry, no. In the beginning, it was only, there it is up top. In 1643, when they're the United Colonies of New England, it was only like four or five. And some of them were called plantations. They didn't hide it. They were at plantations. You'll see in the document. When you read the document, it'll say plantation. We, the United Colonies of New England, at such and such plantation. Yes. It's all business, it's all companies. Yeah. So there you go. They changed their name in 1777. A few years before they actually got the independence. Like, somebody going to change their name? Yeah. United Colonies of New England is the United States of America. And the president of the United States of America is the president of a company, and you think he's your president, and he's suppressing your right to travel. No, he's not. But since you and your mama and your dog believe it, they will keep it in that vein, and they will forever, Wizard of Oz, make it's so. And the only thing that can make it not so is you. So, I just had here. Okay, John Adams, you got to, let me just move on because this is in the paper you have, but as you'll see here, John Adams' analysis is powerful. I got to show you something. And it's also proof of their arrogance. Then 1783, British granted their independence at the Treaty of Paris. 1784, look at the chronology. We are bringing them into business to do commerce, right? Look at the chronology. After they got their independence, then, now the reason why this John Adams letter is there because they were so arrogant, they was asking for a treaty of commerce before they got their freedom. So the John Adams letter basically cusses them out without using cuss words. It's eloquent. It's beautiful. So they're like, sit your behind down, and why don't you learn how to be a plentiful potentiary that you might be, you know, assigned to. We don't even know if you've gotten your freedom yet. Wait till I show you that line. It's powerful. So, and that was in 1780, because they didn't have it until 1783. But, okay, so after the British granted their independence, Treaty of Paris, look what happened in 1784. Treaty of Peace and Friendship. Ratified in 87 because the Moroccan fleet, the Moroccan sun, the Moorish fleet, was security for their behind. They were like, you know, you pay some money to be a bouncer at your party. Please, that's what they were. So, yes, you had to pay them. All right? Now, what happened in 1789 after the treaty? Now, do you see the pattern and the chronology? Do you see it? It all makes sense. And if you don't know the chronology, you're getting all screwed up. Because once you see the chronology, it all makes sense, doesn't it?
Yep.
Tell me that it makes sense.
All
right. This is really the basis of anything else that could be said today, because you're going to end up going home and reading them. But what happened, I got a dotted line here because this is really not relative to them, so to speak, but they started being the monkeys they are and, you know, wanting to put, see, this is what happened. They, even though they got their freedom, you've got to read, Benjamin Banneker's, oh, I got it there. That's on the site under Forgotten Scrolls page. He also says, yo, didn't you just get your freedom? Didn't you just get your freedom? Why are you looking at my brethren with an eye to put him in slavery? And we sitting here fighting to help you get your freedom too. That's the arrogance. But can you blame them? Let's take this point. Not that it makes it right. That's all they knew. What else did they know but slavery? What else? And we need to consider that when we're thinking about ourselves. You can only do what you know. So we need to stop having these people impress upon who we're going to be and are. We do what we do because you can only be what you know. So, the surgery fee Moors in 1790, right, said, yo, wait a minute, hold on, y'all putting up courts and all that kind of stuff like that, I just need you to know I ain't part of that. I will not be heard like the rest of these Negroes. But when he said Negroes, are you aware that he's talking about the modern European? Did you know that the true Negro is him, is the modern European, not you? Yeah. Yeah, that's going to be in another lesson because part of this, on one of them we're going to have, Ms. Raven's going to just hand you down law, American law from the Institution of American Law. That's it. And then we're going to, you've got to use it. You got to do this because the predators see you, us, anyone. And that doesn't have to be, you know, modern Europeans. It could be your own. As stakes on the damn table because you refuse to get to knowing something. Refuse to. So you're a predator. I mean, so you're a stake on the table for the predators. And it don't matter what the predator look like. You shouldn't be a stake on the table, nor should you serve your children up to be either. But you will continue to be, so don't complain. Because you don't want to change it. So then after that, 1791 came the supreme law of the land. And then I referenced Benjamin Banneker's letter because it's kind of interesting to read. All right? Making sense, right? Now, this one we don't have to do because I kind of read it to you. I talked about the Stamp Act and the Boston Tea Party. You can look that up yourself. Know how to read between the lines because, you know, they change things sometimes, but this is pretty much on point. The Boston Tea Party was a political protest in Boston. You hear about it. The Stamp Act was the first, look at that, internal tax levied directly on the American who? Colonists. Don't get it confused. Are you an American colonist? Never was. That ain't talking about you. And this is a great lesson that when you see stuff that they say, oh, it's the law that you got to pay taxes. Oh, it's the law because the statute says this. If you read it, it's not talking about you. Why do you not know that? Because you don't know, let's say it, who is who and what is what. Starting with knowing who you are, your doggone self. Oh, that's Cujo's. Yeah, we like that song. So in between, I wanted to show you, so you, in case you had some sort of other teaching, the British were fighting the Dutch in 1665. That's, you know what I mean? You had the British fighting the French in 1756. The British Moors were always fighting somebody, it seems. And then the Treaty of Paris ended the... now, look, don't get confused. The Treaty of Paris of 1763 ended the French and British War. Don't get it confused with the Treaty of Paris of 1783. Because there was always seven-year wars, a few of them. And then I already did the Boston Tea Party, so on. All right. Now, went back. I didn't know this came up that soon. Y'all seen this, right?
Yeah. So we have the paper, right? But this lesson, we get to see much farther now.
Yeah, this is, ME dug up the information, but I drew this. You know, we actually, I mean, on the computer, we actually, yes, I did. I do all these things. That's what I do. We created it. She dug up all the information, and then she's on the phone, and I'm saying, but wait, that goes there, this goes there. So the unconfusing part, she knows this better than I do, and maybe you'll get a chance to show this at another time. I can deal with it in a matter of time, but it's just that what happens is earlier on in there, it says that, you know, there was agreements to do business and stuff going all the way back to Henry IV and... Okay, so this blue right here is a charter of Arcadia from 16, I think it's 03. Okay, that's Henry IV, France, right? I can't see what this is. That's a, yeah, but 1673. So now check it out. People say, why is there so many treaties to pack? Because that's where your conference room was. That's all. Doesn't it make it? It's where you met. You know, it's like every Wednesday we meet right here. So there it is. So then here granted the province of Maine to Georges, second Mason, 1622. So this is all earlier. What they're showing is that they came over to, you know, like I think he already granted that to them. And then you have the Charter of Plymouth. You heard about that. Plymouth Rock. And the grant of New Hampshire Company, 1629, right? They're both in 1629. Yeah, these got consolidated, right? These two got consolidated, right. But now let's go in the center. Because this just shows from that to that.
Yeah, from like the French way.
Yes. Now go in the center of Virginia Company and look. All of them come up under the Virginia Company. Consume them all. And Virginia Company is still working right now. So when you count them, it's 13 of them. It's 13. That's the 13 colonies. They are what? Companies. They're not the land. They're just land sells territory. But because you thought they were and you wanted to believe they were, they said, good, we are then. And until you change it, it shall remain that way on your ancestral estate where you can't breathe or move. You got companies talking about they run your stuff. But it won't change until you know who is who, period. And we all should want that for our children. Remember, it says the lineal descendants of them, they're colonists, immigrants. What's up? And it doesn't have to be a war. It just has to be, excuse me, back there talking loud. Always the sun. Read it out. It doesn't have to be a war. It has to be the truth that is lived and breathed. That's why, for those who have read the Bible, Bibliothalia text, which is the Bible, it says, and your enemies you shall with your breath destroy, because you have the right words. And their right words is what jurisdiction is. If you don't have it for yourself, you cannot find it, which is the right. It just means right. We ain't talking about no judges and nothing like that. Juris means right, what is just. And diction means word. If you don't have the right words for you, why do you expect someone else to? And Mother Nature and the law of the universe does not care why you don't. There's no respect for person or station. Person being your mask that you show, station being whatever title you think is so great. So if you don't, all right, so you see that now? All of them are right there. They are companies. We show and improve, and this is going to really blow your mind. Well, I'm going to skip through this because of time, but I was trying to do a demonstration. Huh? This is North. This is South America. Yeah, when we say North America includes Canaan land, you know.
Yeah.
But when we say North America,
people just think that.
South America,
yeah.
Central America, and all those joining islands, all of that is the same. So when they say Dominican Republic, they say, I'm Dominican and I'm coming to America. Change the language because you're already in it. In fact, let's do a deductive thinking. Christopher Columbus say he discovered America, right? What's the first place he landed on? Haiti. Da-da. Haiti. Proving to you that, I mean, I ain't got to prove it to you. I think it says North America, South America, and Central America on the map. It's all America.
Where Christopher Columbus is getting information from, like, another queen. Is that queen?
Isabella.
Yeah. And the other guy is Ferdinand?
Yes.
Oh, I just want to know that.
That's later.
They never mentioned their name.
All right. Now, I put this on here to show you that this actually comes out of the record. All right? What's getting ready to go down right here. Look at this. Look, what's it say? The federal and state constitutions, colonial charters, and other organic laws of the states, the territories, and the colonies, now or heretofore doing what? Forming the United States of America. You see, it's on the record. Let the record reflect. Articles of Confederation, I'm only going to do the one paragraph. Remember we said the Articles of Confederation in 1643? This is what it is. Now what I did is her... I can see it. That's all right. I just want to get to a certain spot. The Articles of Confederation between the what? Hey, that's not a good reading. Just go ahead and read it. Come on, everybody. Now, they've identified the party having nothing to do with slave plantations that you were on or thought you were on. What did they have to say in the opening? Let's read that. Whereas we all came into these parts of America with one and the same end and aim, namely to advance the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ and to enjoy the liberties of the gospel and purity with peace. And whereas in our settling by a wise providence of God, we are further dispersed upon the sea coast and the rivers than what was at first intended, so that we cannot, according to our desire, with convenience, communicate in one government and jurisdiction. And whereas we live encompassed with people of several nations and strange languages, which hereafter may prove injurious to us or our posterity. And forasmuch as the natives have formerly committed sundry insolence and outrages upon several plantations of the English, and have of late combined themselves against us, da-da-da. Does that give you a different perspective now? Yeah, it's a wow, right? Da-da. That's why the prophet said study and show yourself a fool. Reasons of those and distractions in England, which they have heard of and by which they know we are hindered from that humble way of seeking advice or reaping those comfortable fruits of protection, which at other times we might well expect. We therefore do conceive it our bounden duty, without delay, to enter into a present association amongst ourselves for mutual help and strength in all our future concernments, that, as in nation and religion, so in other respects, we be and continue one according to the tenor and true meaning of the ensuing articles, wherefore it is fully agreed and concluded by and between the parties or jurisdictions above named, and they jointly and severally do by these present agree and conclude that they all be and henceforth be called by the name of the United Colonies of New England. They came together in their own 1643, just like the chronology says. So I told you that, and the reading in the history binds it for you. That's only the beginning. I'm not reading. You read it. So that's 1643. Now, I wanted to take a second here in my studies. In my studies of this, I wanted to show you something. We tell you that the first month of the year is definitely not January, but it is in fact March. So this is old writings, right? You see it? In testimony whereof, the General Court of the Massachusetts by their secretary and the commissioners for Connecticut and New Haven have subscribed these present articles of this 19th of the third month, commonly called May. What's the third month in your mind?
March. And this is only 1774. No, 1643.
Do you see? So when people say, you know, no, the first, and then you do the logics on it. 8 months would be October, that's an octagon, you know. September is the 7th, you see. Decimal is 10, December. It all makes much sense. It's logical. Even your 7-year-old, if they knew how to read, would put that together. So we have to stop on taking the logic out of our family, out of our children. So I just wanted to show what I did that. I wanted to do that. Because this, I'm going to make a book soon. So another letter to the people of Great Britain, showing you where it came from, edited from the original records in the Library of Congress by Worthington Chauncey Ford, Chief Division of Manuscripts. And this would be the Journals of the Continental Congress, 1774-1789, Volume 1, 1774, Washington Government Printing Office, 1904. They got it. Letter to the people of Great Britain. Now, the people of Great Britain means that these modern Europeans are writing to the British Moors that they have been held as suffering under it and wanting to be free from. And they kind of crying, and they really thought they was family and all that. And they say it in here because they didn't have family. So just the beginning. To the great people of Great Britain, from the delegates appointed by the several English colonies of New Hampshire, Massachusetts Bay, Rhode Island, and Providence Plantations, Connecticut, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, the lower counties on Delaware, Maryland, Virginia, North Carolina, and South Carolina, to consider of their grievances in General Congress at Philadelphia, September 5th, 1774. What did I tell you? They're going to go to the Continental Congress at Philadelphia to lay their grievance down, and so they just wanted to get up. It's like you want to break up with your boyfriend and write a letter and get it off your chest. That's what they did here. But what's interesting is, do you see them calling themselves that they live at plantation? Oh. And every time somebody says plantation, you swear as you would a whip and a chain. Because that's what they wanted you to believe. Because they gave you. See, you got to understand, they really did trade places.
Yeah, I was just seeing that movie yesterday. Put it up.
Because who came over on boats by the drove? They absolutely did. They can't find the boat you came over on drove like that. It didn't happen like that. After they got freedom, right, from the company, they continued slavery because that's all they know. So they turned around to enslave some of us off the coast of Africa. That did happen, but it only happened because our own let it happen. So, friends and fellow subjects, and either they calling the British their friends, they think, and then the rest of their family is the fellow subjects because they know their subjects. When a nation led to greatness by the hand of liberty and possessed of all the glory that heroism, munificence, and humanity can bestow, descends to the ungrateful task of forging chains for her friends and children, and instead of giving support to freedom, turns advocate for slavery and oppression. Sound familiar?
Yeah.
There is reason to suspect she has either ceased to be virtuous or been extremely negligent in the appointment of her rulers. In almost every age, in repeated conflicts, in long and bloody wars as well, civil as foreign, against many and powerful nations, against the open assaults of enemies, and the more dangerous treachery of friends, have the inhabitants of your island, your great and glorious ancestors, maintained their independence and transmitted the rights of men and the blessings of liberty to you, their posterity. So they're going to be breaking off, but they when you read this letter, I think that's all I have on it. I just have the front part. When you read this letter, they really boo-hoo. They really letting it go. Also says, be not surprised, therefore, that we, who are descended from the same common ancestors. Now, that's interesting. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Now, that's another lesson in history. My mother's breath have given you suck. Who do you think made them? We gave up our human DNA to establish them. Okay? But not the way you think it happened. You didn't have, we won't go to that right now. Descended from the same common, it's like artificial insemination stuff.
Yeah.
Same common ancestors that we whose forefathers participated in the rights, the liberties, and the Constitution you so justly boast of, and who have carefully conveyed the same fair inheritance to us. They carefully conveyed the same fair inheritance to us. Two different things here. Guaranteed by the plighted faith of government and the most, that means business, contract deal. And the most solemn compact with British sovereigns, not them, they're not the sovereigns, okay, should refuse to surrender them to men who found their claims on no principles of reason and who prosecute them with the design that by having our lives and our property in their power, they may with a greater facility enslave you. The cause of America is now the object of universal attention. It has at last become very serious. This unhappy country has not only, now it's unhappy for them. Can you imagine that? has not only, where am I? I can't find my place. This unhappy country has not only been oppressed but abused and misrepresented, and the duty we owe to ourselves and posterity to your interests and the general welfare of the British Empire leads us to address you on this very important subject. Know this, that we consider ourselves and do insist that we are and ought to be as free as our fellow subjects in Britain. They're telling you who they are, and that no power on earth has a right to take our property from us without our consent. Dick, can you imagine that this type of conversation was going on then? Doesn't that do something for you? Well, no, I'm just saying, this is the truth, you don't know. Okay, so moving right along. So the Articles of Association, this is the constitutional law of 1774 that Prophet Noble Drew Ali said had not changed in the divine order for the nation. Not only did he tell you to seek the 1774, he said, since it has not changed. And if you understand the relationship, then you would automatically know who you are and automatically know who they are. You see what I'm saying? So he knew that was a key. We, His Majesty's most loyal subjects, the delegates of the several colonies of New Hampshire, Massachusetts Bay, Rhode Island, Connecticut, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, the three lower counties of New Castle, see, they're the same people over and over again, Kent and South Carolina, deputed to represent them in a Continental Congress held in the city of Philadelphia on the 5th day of September, 1774, avowing our allegiance to His Majesty, our affection and regard for our fellow subjects in Great Britain and elsewhere, affected with the deepest anxiety and most alarming apprehensions at these grievances and distresses with which His Majesty's American subject, are you an American subject? Not talking about you. Are oppressed and having taken under our most serious deliberation the state of the whole continent, find that the present unhappy situation of our affairs is occasioned by a ruinous system of colony administration adopted by the British Ministry about the year 1763. Evidently, that was right before the tax, you know, the thing. Right, evidently calculated for enslaving these colonies and with them the British Empire. Did you ever think they'd be sniveling like that? Seriously, it should change your mind about the reality. In prosecution of which system, various acts of Parliament have been passed for raising of revenue in America, for depriving the American subjects in many instances of the constitutional trial by a jury. Really? Is that what they do to you today?
Yes, well,
supposedly. Exposing their lives to danger by directing a new and illegal trial. Well, really, you're not under their jurisdiction. See, once you understand who's who, then you get that clearer. And so that they shouldn't be calling you to court because they're companies. Companies can't call you to court. Only thing they can call you if you have an injury, if you have a claim against someone against you, it's a flesh and blood being. But not a company. Now you know they're a company. Okay. Several late cruel and oppressive acts have been passed respecting the town of Boston and the Massachusetts Bay, and also an act for extending the province of Quebec so as to border on the western frontiers of these colonies, establishing an arbitrary government therein. and discouraging the settlement of British subjects in that wide extended country. Thus, by the influence of civil principles and ancient prejudices, to dispose the inhabitants to act with hostility against their free Protestant colonies, whenever a wicked ministry shall choose so to direct themselves to do. Didn't know they were complaining, did you? All right, Articles of Association. To obtain redress of these grievances which threaten destruction to the lives, liberty, and property of His Majesty's subjects, their subjects, in North America, we are, and they know they are subjects in North America. We are, how did they become anything other than, we are of opinion that a non-importation, non-consumption, and non-exportation agreement faithfully adhered to will prove the most speedy, effectual, and peaceable measure, and therefore we do for ourselves and the inhabitants of the several colonies whom we represent firmly agree and associate under the sacred ties of virtue, honor, and love of our country as follows. So they getting ready to do the protest. You know, that we're not going to sell anything. Why? Because that's how they, you know, are making this their stance.
Yeah, but they're censoring instead of marching.
They're censoring, right. And they're telling the continental, you know, they're saying they're going to come up under. That's all. But, of course, you know, when you help them, then they turn around and stab you in the back. But that's what people do. So who is who? Time for a reminder. No one can what? Say it louder. Are you a colonist?
No.
Were you American, British subject?
No.
Nobody can change your descent nature. They're not talking about you. And these are books I don't need to show. And we read these on the blog talk. Which ones have we read already?
They were white and they were slaves
is over here.
Right.
All right. All right. Real talk. All right. And you have read many of these. Because the truth is the truth. All we need to do is know that and face that, and we can be real with each other and anyone else in the universe. This is not about trying to have hatred for anyone, because we must learn to love instead of hate. A lie is hateful. A lie is not love. Yes, we were lied to, but in a way, not really, because it's not anybody's responsibility for you to know your heritage and your history. So it's kind of slick like that. But it is time to rise up and do so. Now, now I'm going to do this real quick. I have another slide presentation on the origins of Christianity. It's most important for one reason. You think that Christianity is a religious choice, right? Only. It's a government. The Christian decree is a government, and guess where they operate from? See how we always take things out? They ain't got jack to do with us. Nothing. No. Vatican. Now, why don't you concentrate right here? No. Why do they say that stuff? Because of who?
Todd says that the Archbishop has the position and the authority for all of these so-called municipal officers. Because the Pope already sent a letter saying none of them have any authority to do any business here. And they still do business here. And so, well, they're doing business, but they're still African or human rights.
Everybody has a right to contract.
That's true.
So who cares? If they're doing business, so what?
But it's interfering with our natural rights.
How?
Like, if I want to travel and I don't have their place, they're going to stop me.
What's that got to do with them doing business and operating from the first Bill of Rights?
But they're not.
What are they doing?
They're just doing it.
They're just doing what? What you just said doesn't... They take over... Taking over what?
They're occupying the land.
No.
Okay.
They always occupy the land. I'm occupying it right now.
Yes.
So are you. So I know what you mean. I think I know what you mean. But you know there's rules of occupation, by the way, real occupation, if there were, because I'm not really occupying there. This is my ancestral estate.
Yeah,
you know, this is our place. This is our ancestral estate. So what? Let's get the answer to this, and then you'll see. Constantine was one of the first people to claim conversion to Christianity and establish their first Nicene Council in when? 325 A.D. Constantine's father became Caesar because Caesar is a Christian title. Christians were persecuted, property confiscated, and buildings burned. How many people knew that Christianity and those who wanted to be Christians were persecuted first before they could become Christians? Because before they could be allowed to start their own religion. A couple. Okay, good. This is important. This is important. Constantine was the first emperor to stop Christian persecutions and to legalize Christianity along with all of the religions and cults in the Roman Empire. Constantine made new law, quote, law, addressed to who?
Jews.
Who were really who?
The
really us?
Okay.
They were what? Forbidden to own Christian slaves or to circumcise their slaves. First thing you get in protecting them is those in slavery. Now, I just want to set the premise for that. What's up, baby? What's up? Oh, she wants the bottle. Okay, so check this out. I said to you that the Christian decree is, Christianity is a government decree. Didn't I say that?
Yes.
I asked you, where do they operate from?
Oh, okay.
And we got all the popes of Rome and all that stuff. All right. See, that's going to keep you away from paying attention to what's going on right here, right now. That's real. And when you find out, it's going to blow your mind. No. Quiet down. You don't know. You've had your chance. Let's go there. This is the Christian decree. When we, Constantine and Licinius, emperors, okay, first of all, they got their first milestone to start their religion or to go ahead and start their religion at the Edict of Milan in 312. 313. That's like a milestone. They just fighting. Now, no. 313. I said 12 or 13. They didn't do the Nicene Council together until 320. You know, got that together. But the Edict of Milan was like a milestone. After all the persecuting and fighting, they got their foot in, and then they got allowed to start their own religion. But it's a government. Let me show you. When we, Constantine and Licinius emperors, had an interview at Milan and conferred together with respect to the good and security of the commonwealth, it seemed to us that amongst those things that are profitable to mankind in general, the reverence paid to the divinity merited our first and chief attention, and that it was proper that the Christians and all others should have liberty to follow that mode of religion which to each of them appeared best. So that's why you have the Constitution. You cannot, you know, your religious, exercise your religious freedom. I'm just saying that's where it comes from, natural. But anyway, so that God who is seated in heaven might be benign and propitious to us and to everyone under our government. Hold on, it's better. This should be 1, 2, and 3. When I, Constantine Augustus, and I, Licinius Augustus, came under favor. Now, Constantine is Constantine, and Licinius is his boy. Yeah, you know, there is. Right. Came under favorable auspices to Milan and took under consideration everything which pertained to the commonwealth and prosperity, we resolved among other things, or rather, first of all, to make such decrees as seemed in many respects for the benefit of everyone, namely, such as should preserve reverence and piety toward the deity. We resolve, that is, to grant both to the Christians and to all men freedom to follow the religion which they choose, that whatever heavenly divinity exists may be propitious to us and all, to us and to all that live under our government, right? Whereas we have learned that certain ecclesiastics and others devoting their services, now this is crazy because they were persecuted for wanting to try to have a religion. Look what they turn around and do. Listen to this. Whereas we have learned that certain ecclesiastics and others devoting their services to the church have been compelled by men of different religions to the performance of lustral sacrifices, we decree by this sanction that if any person should suppose that those who devote their services to the most sacred law may be forced to the ritual of an alien superstition, he shall be what? Beaten publicly with clubs, provided that his legal status so permits. If, however, the consideration of his honorable rank protects him from such an outrage, he shall sustain the penalty of a very heavy fine, which shall be vindicated to the what? That's where they operate from. Yeah, that's the folks around the municipality around the corner. Thank you. Because municipality means Roman venue. So when you want to talk about the Roman soldiers, they're right around the corner, right there. Got it? So now, there it is. It's, I told you, I said it, but there it is under the dictionary. An inhabitant of a municipium or town possessing the right of Roman citizenship. You can't go down there and get your right, your map. No, we're not. But we're going down there and paying them some taxes. We're going down there and getting a damn license to get married to somebody when that's not even our thing, giving our name away. Do you see now? You see. And the current day in your face reminder. Let's get back to the forming of the foreigners operating on the Moroccan American soil, the United States of America. And we all know about the Declaration of Independence. You saw the pictures, you know, join or die, because they're a union. They were a union then, they're a union now. The Seven-Year War ended in 1785. The Declaration, as I said, kicked off the Seven-Year War. The British did not want them to be independent. While they wait, they decided to change their union company name to the United States of America. This is what I wanted to show you. This is the Articles of 1777. There it is, right there. Origins of English colonists becoming styled as United States of America. Articles of Confederation of 1777. Now watch the familiarity. Articles of Confederation and perpetual union between the what? States of New Hampshire, Massachusetts Bay, Rhode Island, and Providence Plantations, Connecticut, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Delaware, Maryland, Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia. Article 1. We start the style of this confederacy shall be what?
United States of America.
All right. And they are the same United Colonies we was looking at. They just changed their name.
They just rebranded
themselves. Right. All right, I'm gonna move on, but you know, you can read it when you read it, right? I'm taking time to read it because I don't think I have anything except I wanted to show that, and you know, moving on. This is very important. This is the John Adams letter. analysis of the John Adams letters, excuse me, because, and it's in the documents of history, because John Adams wrote a letter after these crazy fools started asking for things that they shouldn't be asking for yet, because we don't even know if you're free yet. How you want a treaty of commerce when we don't even know if there's peace that's going to be attained? And that's very interesting, because a treaty is war or disgruntlement between two entities. In this case, it would be the British, right, and the United States of America, right, or the Christians, which is the United States of America. And so then the mediator would be the Moroccan Moors, wouldn't it? So we would be considered the home government, right, even when you go look up a consular court, right? So we don't have nothing to do with that. It's for foreigners. By leading you there, take kind of really, really mess us up. So John Adams assigned plenipotentiary delegates for the colonies. He is an assigned plenipotentiary. Wrote a letter requesting a treaty of commerce before they even had received their independence. That's arrogant. There was a corresponding analysis of said letter referred to as the John Adams analysis letter. See, we put this here to show you this is in the documents of American history. This is really, you know, we didn't make this up.
Yeah.
And so that's why sometimes, you know, and it'll pull them all out. And, you know, I like to retype things so they're nice and neat and all that. But then people want to, well, how do we know if it's really real? But, you know, when I first came in and started doing that with the, because I've always done publishing, and I took the George Washington letter, you know, letter to the Sultan and all that, and I dressed it all up. I thought I was making our stuff, you know, and I was, and because they do the same thing in their schools, but we can't do it until we prove to our brethren that it's real. But I get it, because we do need to know. It has been removed from us. Then we can do what we want to do. So why did what you just said, we've been taught anything by Europeans. So that's why the prophet said, go back to the mindset of your ancient foremothers and forefathers. And we have a difficult time doing that because of the brainwashing. All right. Now, I did that. Oops, went the wrong way. I'm not going to read all of this, but this is what it actually is, and this is what I type. I want to read one thing, the beginning, and one line. The reasons which determined the count de regimes to give Mr. Adams that advice are so plain that they must appear at first view. I love this. Don't we love this? This is so great. This is like a cursing out without curse words. He's saying to be solicitous about a treaty of commerce before peace is established is like being busy about furnishing a house before the foundation is laid. Now, there's a few more places. Like for instance, he says something being chimerical. I had to go look up the word chimerical. It means funny, laughable. So, you know, if this is chimerical, sounds nice, but they're saying, you know, you're a joke. All right? So I might use the word chimerical from that point on. But there was one more. Yeah. All this is interesting, but I don't want to, where is it? You know what I'm looking for? Okay, here it is. A person, now this is where he's cussing them out. Let's go to three. To propose a treaty of commerce which must be sound, well, all of this really is straightening them out. To propose a treaty of commerce which must be founded on confidence and on a union equivalent to an alliance at a time when a war is raging and all of its fury, when the Court of London is wishing to ruin or to subjugate you Americans. Not talking about us, they're talking about them. What is it? But to give credit to the opinion which all Europe entertains already, conformable to the assertions of the English ministers, that the United States inclines towards a defection, because they're not honorable. So they're saying, and that they will be faithful to their engagements with France until such time as Great Britain will furnish a pretext for breaking those agreements. They're really talking about the British on that one, though. They did not want to free them and give them their independence. They really didn't. It was really bad. So a person may be furnished eventually with plenipotentiary powers without being under the necessity of publishing it until circumstances permit it to be. This happens every day, Mr. Adams. This happens every day. Mr. Adams, well, he's charged with three distinct commissions. One, take a share in the future negotiations. Miss, can you ask him to get me something to drink? Thank you. Future negotiations for peace. Two, conclude a treaty of commerce with Great Britain. Three, represent the United States in the Court of London. It requires no great effort of genius, that's what they're telling them, to show that these three objects cannot be accomplished at the same time, same moment of time, nor that something too that the two last cannot serve as an introduction to the first. Here it is. I want y'all to pay very close attention. This is written in 1780. It is necessary, first of all, to obtain from England an acknowledgement of the independence of America. Do you get it? Oh, you didn't have to do that.
Oh,
I thought you just... Thank you. Oh, thank you. I didn't know you had any of it. So did you see that right there? They're not even free. Are independent. They're company. Do you see? But it also shows their arrogance. It's a very interesting letter. I'm definitely not going to read it all. I'm going to skip through here. And that's another part of it. It's all very interesting. I put a bit of that up. Finally, they received their independence in 1783, the Treaty of Paris. 1783, British granted their independence as a company via the Treaty of Paris between Great Britain under King George III and the American colonies. This ended the Seven-Year War, also referred to as a Revolutionary War. Not the Revolutionary, but a Revolutionary War. You see now? See? See, they never told you about their little stuff. Okay, so then, I don't really need it, but here it is. His Britannic Majesty acknowledges the said United States, and then they name who the United States is. New Hampshire, Massachusetts, Bay, Rhode Island, Providence, Plantations, Connecticut, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Maryland, Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, all the same parties that have been in this in the first place, right? There it is. Now, they really couldn't make them, the British could acknowledge them, but this wasn't the British's land. So when they say free states, they're talking about a company. They're not talking about the land.
Yeah.
Okay. It's just that they're acknowledging them to have their own sales territory. And I just put this. This is an actual copy of the last page of the Treaty of Paris. But, you know, you'll see it there. Like, they have little roses on there. You know, everybody took much pride in their writings and stuff. Because that was a form of seal, a wax seal. So, you know, because it's so important. Because when you write, you literally, it's spelling, right? You literally are casting a spell. Not a curse. Because I had someone tell me that they didn't want to sign their autograph in cursive because it means it's a curse. I said, well, I do hope that when you are writing, you are casting spells. But whether it's a curse, a bad one, that's up to you. But some people will teach you that. Don't do that. So now what they're doing in elementary school, in school where they're teaching your children, they're only teaching them to print. And I'm telling you, this has to stop. Mothers and fathers, they're not even going to teach them how to write in cursive. They're never going to be able to.
The reason why we write in script or in cursive is like, let's say you go to college and when somebody gives you first aid, it's a faster form of writing, so you don't have to like stop it.
It's casting a spell.
Yeah. No, that's I'm just saying what I've
No, because that would be shorthand, and I know shorthand. I haven't used it. Now, this is funny because I had this in here. An agreement or contract made by belligerent parties in which they agree to lay down their arms in which they... Okay, I put this in here, but we don't need to go over this. And then I think I've done what I wanted to do in this. Let me just see where I am. A treaty of peace was drafted for who? Christian ministers. Nothing to do with you in that respect. Everywhere you see. Now, whenever you can show and prove that something has nothing to do with you, and then a person is going to do it anyway, the only reason that happens is because clearly at that moment, they have another agenda. That's it, and that's all. No problem. Ministers, plenty potential. I was given a definition in a minister, international law, officer appointed by the governor of one nation as a mediator or arbitrator between two other nations who are engaged in the controversy with their consent. See, a lot of people think that they look at Moors as if this isn't their land, that as if they're the foreigner, and that's the problem. And as long as you do that, you can never, you're a hypocrite if you say that you are a national and this is your ancestral state, then you go do stuff as if you're a foreigner. And think the rest of the world don't see that? Okay. So, moving along, Treaty of Peace and Friendship, I'm not even going to go through that. We've all read the treaty, we all know about the Treaty of Peace and Friendship, right? Okay. And this is just something, actually, what I did here was, I thought, here we go, I'm done about now, I think. Okay. Supreme law of the land, after the treaty, the supreme law of the land was established, the Moroccan American Republic Constitution for all who operate, occupy upon the land, all. The land remains as your ancestral estate, national domicile, North America. It clearly brought the modern European companies into the constitutional fold. The rules of engagement are for the people and the companies, corporations, as scribes within it. No one is to violate the other. The articles in the Constitution are for the companies, and the Bill of Rights secure the inalienable rights and liberties of the people. The only thing that is a law is the Bill of Rights. The Bill of Rights is for the natural people. Doesn't matter what their nationality is. It's for the natural people. The articles in the Constitution are for what for companies. That's why it says what they can and cannot do. Right? But the Bill of Rights, starting off with one, is talking about what the people can and cannot do. Do you notice? I mean, what the people's inalienable rights that are preserved, reserved, and retained. Well, actually, it's not retained because you have to retain it. But you can. But are you retaining them? Because they have to be retained by you. So, you know, we'll have on our cards, we have all rights reserved and retained. Meaning I'm retaining all my rights because I know what they are and I'm keeping them. But if you don't do that, then you don't have them. You don't have them. So it's interesting that there's a group of Moors somewhere that actually believes the reverse, that the articles are for the natural people. That's how twisted we are. But it's easy to do because you just saw how this whole thing is flipped, right? You saw it, didn't you? But you got to study to show yourself approved for real. I thought this was the beginning of certification from the, on the, it is from the Library of Congress, but it's for what? The Constitution or? Oh yeah, Constitution. I was trying to get the one for the, I thought it was the one for the treaty. And then lastly, so when you get into the Constitution, the laws of the United States bind what? Now, hold on a moment. The siren is going past. We're in New York, at New York. Can we read this together?
The
binds the powers and the functions of the state to be measured by its principles and its articles, and has priority and supremacy to the state. The state must conform to all national purposes and constitutional provisions. Any questions? Do states make law? Never. So when they tell you, oh, that's the new law, they're telling you because they know you don't know, Jack. But when we know all of this, then it will be as the Prophet Noble Drew Ali said, it'll be over by breakfast, a breakfast fight. But some people, we can't even come and sit at the breakfast table. And then they want to know what's wrong. It's a serious talk here. You can't even sit at the breakfast table. So how can you benefit from it being over by breakfast? We have to be in the same direction, not, you know, forced to be or this to be, but you got to go down your little yellow brick road, and when you go down that road for you, you're going to find others that are in the same direction. So get on down that road. It's your lesson. Who always says that? It's your lesson. I don't know why it's happening. It's your lesson. I have to make me so mad. Don't you know? It sounds cold, don't it? But it's the truth. It's cold. It's cold. But it's the truth. How's someone else going to know why something's happening to you? It's happening to you because of something that's happening to you. All right. It makes you feel like, oh, nobody cares. But, okay, I don't need to do this. Oh, yeah, I do. The Constitution is a written instrument. As such, its meaning does not alter. That which it meant when it was what? Adopted, and it's telling you it's adopted. It means when? Now. We, this is them saying, this is interpretation or trying to interpretate, we are bound to interpret the Constitution in the light of the law as it existed at the time it was adopted. People think, oh, it's a different time now. We need some new stuff now. Well, when the Prophet was here, didn't he say, you know, now it's different. Didn't he say that he's dealing with principles? Didn't I just tell you principles don't change? So how do you know if you're not going to put it on and wear it and try it? At least that. We want to do all of this and this process and that new thing, and we haven't even worn what it is that we're supposed to be wearing. We haven't done that yet. We do everything but that. Everything but that. Then people say, well, I went in there, I did this, and I was constitutional. Look, when we get this thing straight, we won't even be bothering about going in these happy to clown kangaroos, because they only set them up and call you in there because you come. Yep. And they said, well, if we don't come, then... If we don't come, why is it that? There's a tab that pulls up? Oh, I see it. I got it. If we don't come, they're going to arrest us. No, they're kidnapping you. They're not. Huh? They don't deal with principles. Right. So, as you've heard Adam Eve saying, we all say, if the law's not on the table, you better put it on the table. If we all did it, it would be over. But that's why people come and try to make a diversion. It's called scatter the sheep, as they use in those terms. That's why they do it. Because as long as we stay here, they stay up there. But it's going to happen. But look, when this thing does shift, because it's coming, you need to be worried about what you're going to do. Because you no longer going to be able to complain about no quote-unquote white man and what he did to me. And all that bull crap. Because the truth is, we had them in slavery first. So let's kill that noise and stop using it as a crutch and let knowledge change our position. All right. What time is it, Anna? What?
Yes.
After 10?
Yes, after 10.
You should have told me.
Well, I thought you was wrapping it up.
under the United States Republic's constitutional system of government and upon the individuality and intelligence of the citizen, the state does not claim to control one's conduct to others. That leaves one the sole judge as to all that affects oneself. No, I'm going to have to finish it another time. Yeah, but I need you to close out and say whatever you're going to say. Let me just see where I left off. You think?
Yeah.
I don't think it's that much on it left. Where's the thing? I'm just trying to move to the next one so I know her. Oh, Article 6, getting to the Constitution. Because you were told to enforce the Constitution as of the one supreme issue. And everything that happens, it takes you away from it instead of doing it. And then, here we got this new process. We got this process and that process. And it's like, have you enforced the Constitution, you know? Is it on your dial plate in your spirit, the spirit of law? No, we're going to do this process thing. And that's what happens. That it just totally takes you away from it. Because they can't get under it. They can't get under it. They can't get over it. So, huh? You can't. It's real talk. And then they'll have their little statutes, policies, or not policies. Not that. What is that when they say pursuant to some of them? But some of them are codifying law. But if you look at it and you know what it is, you always put the Constitution up to it because the remedy is even in their stuff. But that doesn't mean you go rely on their stuff. Never. You see where that remedy is, and you always put the Constitution up to it because you're not relying on that. You know, and you don't really, and Anna Eve was saying, if you will, that you stop even saying a whole bunch of case laws because they play that game. They do? But how do they play that game? It's just a game. They just say, they try to negate enough. Can you cut yourself on? and explain that real quick so we can.
They will, like if you put a case law on the table, they will come back with another case law to counter your case law. Then you'll put another one on the table. And then you'll come back with another one to counter it. And you'll be going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. So then you're going to put a Constitution on the table. They can't come back with one.
That's it, that's all. They can't come back. That's why the prophet said there is but one supreme issue, and that is to enforce the Constitution for the United States or even of America. It means it's for them so that you can keep them where? At bay and off your butt and arm's length.
Case law usually they're violating.
Huh?
Case law usually they're violating.
The reason case laws were even established is because this is the law, right? And somebody tried to violate it against somebody, and that somebody took it all the way, took the claim all the way to court, and that's how a daggone case law got established in the first place.
A lawyer might not write that case law, they bring him back.
Huh?
Resolve, like,
really
have this kind of matter,
yeah.
How we handle it in court.
Yeah.
We don't have to, like.
That's why you do that. But let's be clear, too. When you say lawyer means layman, means the law, lawman. The only true lawyers would be you.
Yeah, right.
But what they are, because it's layman, are attorneys.
Attorney, you
give me a power. Oh, yeah. But you understand why not. So, yes. I'm sorry, the light is.
Case law brings you right into that very dangerous jurisdiction. That's why you want to definitely avoid it.
you're putting yourself right in the jurisdiction where they don't have to respect yourself.
Now, you said separate what?
Yourself from the corporate entity.
Well, that's a great idea, but there's too many people have taught more to go into commerce as if they are a corporation. They're doing it still now. And it's unfortunate because that led them away. We saw it all happen. That led them away also. They all, you know, everything is commerce to them. They think that they are the product, you know. So like for instance, you know, like what we would do is like they would say, well, you know, I'm glad this one's over, I think. They would say, well, we're the product. And the reason why they have jurisdiction over me is because of the birth certificate, let's say, right? All right. So then if you really did think that, why would you be the one to bring that to the court? Why wouldn't you let them lay it on the table? We're so anxious and out of order that we literally go get the birth certificate, check it, like, yeah, and I authenticated it. It's asinine. If you truly believe that the reason why this, say, the magistrate, or the, you want to call it a judge, or this court, or this company, has jurisdiction over you is because of the birth certificate, why don't you let him put it on the table? No, we're so stupid, we go get it ourselves. Now he don't have to admit nothing you just did.
We'll get you the rules that you can hang us to, basically.
I mean, we're so uninformed. I'm sorry, not stupid. Let me change that. That's not right. Uninformed. Because, as Yahshua said, my people suffer from a lack of knowledge. That's it and that's all. So with that, I think, we got to go. Any other questions? No? Well, guess what? We're going to be here next Wednesday. Will you join us?
Yes.
We're going to be here. We're going to finish that a little bit, and then Anna Eats going to introduce. Because, see, if you can get the foundation of this right here, this is a perfect example of learn by degrees and foundation. If you can accept this truth as the foundation, now you're ready for the mega stuff that she wants, I'm going to call it mega stuff, that she wants to lay on you or share with you. But you first need the foundation to know that and accept it. Now you can receive it right. All right? So with that, thank you very much. Wait a minute, we got. All right, Brother Lawrence. Wait a minute, hold on, Lawrence. Why can't I just give it to him? I've been standing all day. No, it's not.
Oh, here, that's the mic.
Oh, I don't need that.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't. Over the air. I know. I wasn't gonna leave.
All right.
It's love. We have 45 to be able.
All right.
Five on the left. Two on the right. Repeat after me.
Allah.
Father of the universe.
Father of the universe.
Father of love.
Father of love.
Truth.
Peace.
Freedom.
Freedom.
Injustice. Allah is my protector.
Allah is my protector.
My guide.
My guide.
And my salvation.
And my salvation.
My night.
By night
and by day.
And by day.
school's coming up and the world is in their hands. When you teach the children, teach them the very best you can. If we just let it be, na 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 na, the world won't get no better. We gotta change it, girl, just you and me. Wake up all the doctors, make the old people well. They're the ones who suffer and who catch all the hair. But they don't have so very long before their judgment day. So won't you make them happy before they pass away? Wake up all the builders, time to build a new land. I know we could do it if we all lend a hand. The only thing we have to do is put it in our minds. Surely things will work out, they do it every time. Let it be. The world won't get no better. We gotta change it, just you and me.
Health is like your playlist. You never know what's coming next. Whether you need a checkup, new medicine, or something more urgent. You need to know where to go. Enter Emory. With access to over 120 primary care locations and nearly 60-minute clinics and urgent care centers across the region, where you're in the hands of specially trained doctors and nurses, so you're covered no matter what. Click on this banner to find a location near you